Happy New Year. Man, we are so glad that you're here today. I'm assuming it's the new year. I was in bed at 11 o'clock last night, and I'm just assuming the ball dropped and we made it into 2017. Can you get anybody testify to that? Did we actually make it? Okay, great. This is probably the first year that I have slept through the new year, but I kind of liked it, so I think I'm going to make it a pattern for years to come, that just to go to sleep and sleep through the new year. Hey, I want to tell you some really cool stuff. Let me pull this up here real quick. I want to tell you some really cool stuff about 2016. Now, I know we could go on and on about 2016, maybe the good, the bad, and the ugly of it. And some of you are probably glad that we're in a new year because it gives us a fresh start. But I want to share with you some cool stuff about 2016, just some stuff just from around here at the church at Spencer Christian. Let me pull this up real quick so I make sure that I am accurate with what I share with you today. One of the cool things this past year is we went into what we call our Beyond Forward Challenge. Back in February, we began talking about it, and then we're going to remind you of it this coming March as we renew that. It was a two-year commitment that we made to over and above giving, but more than that, to reaching out further and getting more people involved in ministry and doing what we could do to see more people come to Jesus. And so we've not talked a lot about that other than we just occasionally remind you of the Beyond Forward Challenge. And how God's not finished with us yet. We've not arrived yet, where there's more that we're stretching out to do as a church and to become in the name of Jesus. But some cool things that's happened this year here at the church is one of our goals in the Beyond Forward Challenge was to have within two years, to have 500 people serving on our Serve to Worship Sunday that we have every fall. And I just wanted to let you know that this year we had almost 500. So we almost met our two-year goal in the first year. There were nearly 500 of us who went out and served on the Serve to Worship weekend. So give the Lord a big hand for that. We're real excited about that. That's a crazy thing that we do once a year when we come together for a short worship service, and then everybody goes out and you are the sermon that weekend as you go out to serve others in our community. And so we really look forward to just busting that 500 mark, just going way over top of that this coming September during our Serve to Worship. Another cool thing is that there are more people who are serving here at Spencer Christian Church. You're serving in the community, or you're serving through the ministries which take place here at the church, and that was one of our goals, is that we would get more people involved in service, and so we're very thankful for that. As a matter of fact, our congregation, Thanksgiving, served our community by providing 75 food baskets for 75 different families in our community. And then at Christmas, yeah, go ahead and applaud that. God gets the glory. God gets the glory for all that. But at Christmas, we as a congregation, and this is only the number, we don't sit around and count this stuff up, but we were able to track it this year, and we know that we served at least 120 families in our community this year at Christmas time. And I'm convinced that several of you did some service for folks in our community that we don't know about, that didn't go in that 120 number that we do know about. And so we're just thankful for that. But let me share this with you. This last thing I want to share with you that we want to celebrate together today is we had been praying. I had personally been praying for a while for there to be 100 additions in our church. For about 7 years, I've been praying that there would be 100 additions, new additions, people coming to the Lord through baptism or coming into our church through transfer in a year's time. And so I invited you guys, I think a couple of years ago about this time, to pray that with me, to pray for 100 additions. And then in our Beyond Challenge, we actually stepped that up a little bit, and we want to see even more people come. But we've been praying for 100 additions. And then I told you that after we make that mark of 100 additions, my prayer is going to shift, and I encourage that your prayer will too, that we'll see 100 baptisms in the course of 1 year. So let me tell you about what happened in that area of our church in 2016. In 2016, we had 66 baptisms and 60, no, I'm sorry, we had two more last night, 70, and last night was still last year, so 71 transfers, people who transferred their membership to the church, which means that for the year, we had 137 new additions to our church. So if you've been praying for 100 additions, now your prayer needs to be for 100 baptisms in the course of a year. And I can't think of a better year than 2017 that we see at least 100 people come to Jesus this year. Just to kind of give you some perspective, the first 4 years of our 19-year church history, in the first 4 years, we never averaged on a weekend more than 135. And we added that many this year. And so it just goes to show God's faithfulness and how good he is to us. It's been our biggest year of growth ever. Up until this time, our largest year of growth, I think, was 2015, where we had somewhere around 85 to 88 additions that year. And so we see that God is doing some pretty incredible stuff because we recognize what the Bible teaches. We can sow and we can water, but he brings the increase, right? And because he brings the increase, he gets the glory. Amen? Amen. So we're very thankful for God blessing our church and thankful for your part in that, your faithfulness and the recognition of the faithfulness of God. And we look forward to this new year to be able to reach more people for Jesus, to be able to serve more people in the name of Jesus, and to be able to make Jesus more famous in our community, right? We want to make it hard to go to hell in Spencer County. So that's what we're striving to do, and that's what we'll continue to strive to do in 2017, just like we strived to do that in 2016, and God gets all the glory. Amen? All right. Open your Bibles up, if you will, to Matthew chapter 5. This morning, we start a 9-part sermon series. It's going to be the month of January and February, where we're going to take a look at the Beatitudes. Now, you'll find the Beatitudes in Matthew chapter 5, and it's actually a part of Jesus' famous Sermon on the Mount, really a complete sermon that we have from beginning to end that Jesus preaches in the book of Matthew. It's recorded for us, but he begins that with this little section of Scripture that has been named the Beatitudes. Now, let me tell you what a Beatitude is. A Beatitude, simply put, is a statement of blessing. That's what it is. It's a statement of blessing. And so what Jesus does in these first few verses that we're going to be looking at together, what Jesus does is he makes 8 statements of blessings. That if you do this, you will be blessed. People who do this are people who are blessed, is what Jesus says. Now, what gets everyone's attention is that what Jesus says is contrary or counterculture to the first century culture that the Jewish people lived in there in Palestine. It's different than what the Roman Empire preached and taught during the first century. What Jesus says you're blessed by is opposite of what the culture of his day said you were blessed by. You see, the Roman Empire, it was all about might and power, and you're blessed when you're strong. You're blessed when you take charge. You're blessed when you're obedient to the Roman government and the Roman and Caesar, who is their king. And really, the truth of it is, not much has changed in 20 centuries. In the 21st century, we still kind of have the same philosophy of life, that you're blessed when you take charge. Blessed is the man who gets up and takes care of things himself, right? The man who can stand on his own 2 feet, the person who's a go-getter, who goes out and does things, that's how you reap blessings in life. So what Jesus is going to be teaching us over the next few weeks together is going to be countercultural. It's going to be different than what our culture today teaches. But if we listen, he'll open the eyes of our hearts and we'll begin to recognize where true blessings come from. Because really, we all desire to be blessed. And so the Beatitudes help us to understand that. Each week, we'll take a Beatitude and we'll break it down. So I'm going to begin reading in Matthew chapter 5. Begin reading in verse 1. But the first Beatitude we find in verse 3. It says, "Now when he saw the crowds," speaking of Jesus, "he went up on a mountainside and sat down. And his disciples came to him, and he began to teach them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.'" The very first beatitude or blessing, a statement of blessing that Jesus gives is this. He says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Now, I'm going to be honest with you. In the American culture, and the typical American doesn't find anything blessed about being poor in anything, right? We don't run around saying, blessed are you when you're poor at the bank. Blessed are you when you're poor. In fact, we see the American dream is the opposite of being poor. It's about having wealth. It's about having prosperity. People came to this nation in droves because they wanted to find a better way. They wanted to escape poverty. And so when we hear this, blessed are the poor in spirit, it automatically grabs us and says, wait a minute, this is confusing to me. How can it be blessed to be poor in spirit? In fact, how can you be blessed to be poor in anything, right? Unless you're poor in troubles. That's what I want to be, poor in troubles, right? How can you have blessings from this? But Jesus is teaching us something. You see, we live in a culture of can-dos. We can do it, right? We can fix it. We can medicate it. We can replace it with something else if we don't like it. We live in a culture of we can do it. We can work through this. And it's important for us to recognize that there may be some things you can do, but most things in life, listen, you're not as in charge as much as you think you are. We don't control as much as we think we control. Now, Tim Keller says it this way. Here's what Tim Keller says. Tim Keller's a preacher and a writer. He says to be poor in spirit just simply means this. It means that you are deeply in debt before God, that you recognize that you have a debt, and that debt is before God. And that's what poor in spirit means. Keller goes on to say this. He says there's two ways of looking at God. See if you fit into one of these two ways. He says there's two ways of looking at God. One way of looking at God is this, that I have nothing of value, God owes me nothing, he would be just to cut me off, but I rely completely on what Jesus Christ has done for me, and I ask that he accept me. That's one way of looking at God. Now the second way, Keller says, to look at God, the second approach is like this. I've lived a fairly good, decent life. God owes me something. He owes me comfort. And he shouldn't let bad things happen to me. You see, to be poor in spirit is when you come to this place where you recognize that spiritually, without God, you are bankrupt. That there is nothing that you can do to merit God's favor. The book of Isaiah says that our greatest deeds are like filthy rags before God. Your greatest deeds in life, your greatest accomplishments in life, whatever they may be, are like filthy rags before God. Even your greatest accomplishments in the name of the Lord are nothing compared to God. There's nothing that we can do to merit God's favor. I personally, and you also, we cannot take care of our sin problem by ourselves. We need a Savior. You see, that debt is too high for us to pay. There's nothing that we could do if we lived 1,000 lifetimes. There's nothing that we could do where we could be good enough to merit the favor that God gives us. So as we stand before God, we must recognize that without Him, we are nothing. We are spiritually bankrupt, and that's what it means to be poor in spirit. Coming to the conclusion that you recognize that your only hope rests in Jesus Christ. Your only help is in Christ and in Christ alone. And there's nothing that you can do to get yourself out of your sin problem. The mess that we're all in. Because that's one thing we have in common. And that we need a Savior to do it. We need Jesus to do it. The Bible gives us the perfect example of being poor in spirit in the story in Luke chapter 18 of the Pharisee and the tax collector. In Luke chapter 18, we're given this example. Jesus is speaking to his disciples, and he tells them the story of the Pharisee and a tax collector. They both come to the temple to worship, and as the Pharisee comes to pray to the Lord, he stands out where everyone can see him, and he prays in a loud voice, and here's what he says. The Pharisee says, God, I thank you that I am not like other people, that I am not like robbers and evildoers and adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week, and I give a tenth of all that I have. That's how the Pharisee approaches God. God, I thank you that I'm something special. I'm a Pharisee. I'm a religious leader. People look up to me because I walk close with you, Lord. I'm not like the robbers, and I'm not like the evildoers. I'm not like the adulterers. I'm not like this tax collector. I pray and I fast. I'm something. But then it says the tax collector comes. And as he approaches the Lord, he doesn't even feel worthy to stand in the presence, and he doesn't even lift his eyes up, but he prays in humility. And he says this, he says, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. And then Jesus asks his disciples, which prayer do you think had value with God? Paraphrase here. Which prayer do you think God heard? And they said, obvious. Well, let me just ask you, which prayer do you think God heard? Yeah, the tax collector's prayer. I'm a sinner. He was taking an honest evaluation of his situation. And because he came before God poor in spirit, he got the attention of God. Now, it's easy for us to believe that we can handle life in our own might and our own power. It's easy for us to believe that we have things under control and we can take care of business. In fact, some of us in this very room have real issues with control, right? And when I say some of us, I don't have to get on the other side of this podium to find somebody. We have real issues with control, and we really believe that we've got it all covered, that we can work it all out, that it all is going to fall into place because, listen, we're strong and we're competent and we're able and we can do it. But the truth of it is, when it comes to the Lord, we are helpless and we are hopeless without Him. And so we must approach Him as one who is poor in spirit. In James chapter 1, it talks about the importance of humility. Listen as I read beginning in verse 9. It says, believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. Well, that's just backwards thinking right there, right? Believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. But the rich should take pride in their humiliation, since they will pass away like a wild flower. For the sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossoms falls, and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, the rich will fade away even while they go about their business. Now, if you've ever traveled outside of the United States of America, you will recognize that we are the rich, right? Especially if you've traveled to some third world countries, that we're the ones who are so easily lured to being haughty in our spirit rather than being poor in spirit. That we believe that we can manage and handle things. And here it just simply says that when you're humble and you're in humble circumstances, that you're in a high position, because when you fall into the trap of being wealthy or having a lot, you can sometimes be deceived in the fact that you've got things under control. Matthew chapter 19, verse 23, Jesus says to his disciples, truly, I tell you, it's hard for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of heaven. Doesn't mean a rich person can't enter the kingdom of heaven. He just says it's harder. And the reason that it's harder is because we got plenty. And when we have plenty, somewhere along the way, we really believe that we're the source of all that. And that we can handle things. And that we can take care of things without being humble before the Lord. Psalms 25:9, the psalmist writes of the Lord, He guides the humble in what is right, and He teaches them His way. Psalms 147:6, the Lord sustains the humble, but casts the wicked to the ground. Proverbs 3:34, He mocks proud mockers, but shows favor to the humble and oppressed. To be poor in spirit is to simply come to a place where you humble yourselves before God and you recognize that you need Him more than anything else. As much as you need the next meal you will eat or the next breath you will draw, you need Jesus. And so that brings us to this place where we recognize that we are spiritually bankrupt without the Lord and that we need Him. John Piper, who travels around the countries and does lectures, and he was doing a lecture to a group of students talking about the value of Christianity. And after the lecture was over with, a student came up to him and asked him a question that maybe you've heard before. He said it wasn't the first time nor the last time he heard it. The student's question was this. After John had spoke about Christianity, the student says, isn't Christianity a crutch for people who can't make it on their own? Have you ever heard that? People say that about Christianity. Isn't Christianity a crutch for people who can't make it on their own? That was the question. And John Piper's answer was, yes. Yes, it is. We can't make it on our own, folks. And when we try to make it on our own, it leads us in pathways that lead us to misery, selfishness. It leads us away from the Lord rather than drawing us near. And those that we have relationship with, it pushes them away from the Lord rather than drawing them near to the Lord as well. We can't make it without Jesus. And that's simply what Jesus is teaching here when he says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Here's what happens when you're poor in spirit, when you're humble before the Lord, when you're completely sold out and surrendered to Christ, and you realize that you are nothing without him. When you're poor in spirit and you come to him, here's what happens. It says that theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, Matthew loves this phrase, the kingdom of heaven. He uses it around 32 times in the Gospel of Matthew. He absolutely wears it out. Nobody else, no other writer in the New Testament uses this phrase like Matthew does. It's one of his favorite phrases talking about the kingdom of heaven. If you read through the book of Matthew, he'll give you all kinds of examples of what the kingdom of heaven is like. He'll tell a story by saying, the kingdom of heaven is like this. You know, like a man who found a treasure in a field. He went and sold everything that he had, and he went back and bought the field that had the treasure in it. The kingdom of heaven is like this. And he gives all these examples of what the kingdom of heaven is like. Now, I want you to understand that when you read this phrase, the kingdom of heaven, it is the same as reading the phrase, the kingdom of God, which is also used in the New Testament, the kingdom of God. And Matthew even uses the term, the kingdom of God. It's interchangeable with the kingdom of heaven. And Paul, in Ephesians, writes about the kingdom of God and of Christ. Same kingdom, okay? So don't get confused, and sometimes folks will try to confuse you on this issue. Don't get confused about what he's talking about when he talks about the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of heaven is God's kingdom. It's his people, it's his way, and Jesus is teaching about the kingdom of heaven. Jesus ushers the kingdom of heaven in, and it is a literal kingdom that is now in existence, because if you're in God's family, you're a part of his kingdom, amen? Okay? And it's also written about for all eternity, too. It is an eternal kingdom. Out of all the kings and kingdoms that have ever came and have ever existed, the kingdom of heaven is the only one that's eternal. And it's the one that belongs to God. And if you belong to him, you're a part of his kingdom. Does that make sense? And so here it says that the kingdom, that those who are poor in the spirit will inherit the kingdom of heaven. I want to read some other passages to you. From Matthew chapter 5, verse 20, Jesus says this, when we're thinking of God's kingdom. He says, for I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. Well, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were the religious leaders of the day. Right? We've already read about one Pharisee who stood on the corner and prayed out loud and talked about how great he was and how much better he was than everybody else, right? And Jesus says that unless your righteousness surpasses the religious leaders of the day, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. And then he says this in Matthew chapter 18, verse 3 says, and Jesus said, truly I tell you, unless you change, go ahead and underline change. This is a great season for change, right? Unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. All right, so we're told now that to be like the religious leaders isn't going to get you to the kingdom of heaven, but to be like little children will. And so he echoes that in the very next chapter, chapter 19, verse 14. Jesus said, let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these. See, this is where this upside-down thinking comes in, upside-down for us, because we live in a culture that teaches us that to be great means you've got to strive for greatness. You've got to be successful, and you've got to be accomplished, and you've got to do things. And self-reliance, listen, the American way is all about self-reliance. One of the gifts I got for Christmas, hey, let me tell you one of the gifts I got for Christmas. I racked up at Christmas this year. I did. I don't have any grandkids yet, so I'm getting all kinds of good stuff. That'll change one of these days. But one of the gifts I got for Christmas my daughter Hannah gave me a survival kit. So in the survival kit, I have a fire starter, a magnesium fire starter. So if you need fire at your house, just call me. I can come over. I can get a fire going. I got a life straw. You know what a life straw is? A life straw is a straw with a filter on it, and that means that I can go out into the woods and drink out of muddy puddles of water because I've got this straw that will filter it all out. So I got it made. I'm going to take a life straw with me. I'll never be without water because I can just drink out of anything because of this straw with a filter on it. And then I got a 12-in-1 ultimate survival tool, and it fits in my wallet. Means I can carry it with me everywhere I go, and it's got like 12 functions. It's just this big, but it's got like a saw and a knife and wrenches and screwdrivers. It does all these different functions, okay? And so I feel like that in any survival situation, I'm your man now. Because I got these things. I got this straw, I got this fire starter, and I got this ultimate survival tool. In fact, you could just drop me down anywhere, and I can take care of any problem because I can survive, I can do it. Drop me in the Middle East, there will be no more ISIS because I'll take care of things really quick. You know, I got these tools to take care of it. And you catch what I said in that? It's all about me. I can survive. I can do it. I have the ability. I'm not very poor in spirit. And that's what being poor in spirit is all about. When you come to this place of recognition that you realize, hey, I'm bankrupt without Jesus. And I can't do anything. So I must surrender to Him. You see, this ideal of humility is instrumental to the Christian faith. This is what Jesus taught His apostles. When He taught them that if you want to be great in My kingdom, you learn to wash each other's feet. You learn to serve one another. He gives a little bit of instruction that I want to leave you with to us through Peter and his writing in 1 Peter. So if you want to flip your Bible over to 1 Peter chapter 5, I'm going to read a few verses. But what I want to encourage you with is here, Paul is giving instruction to elders, the leaders of the local church, on how they should lead. Listen to what he says. He says, "To the elders among you, I appeal as a fellow elder and a witness of Christ's sufferings, who also will share in the glory to be revealed. Be shepherds of God's flock that is under your care, watching over them, not because you must, but because you are willing, as God wants you to be. Not pursuing dishonest gain, but eager to serve. Not lording it over those entrusted to you, but being examples to the flock. And when the chief shepherd appears, you will receive a crown of glory that will never fade away." Now, he's speaking to leaders here who have authority, and what he's telling them is to be humble and serve others. And then he goes on, "In the same way, you who are younger, submit yourself to your elders. All of you clothe yourselves with humility towards one another." And here's why. "Because God opposes the proud, but shows favor to the humble. Humble yourselves, therefore, under God's mighty hand, and He will lift you up in due time. Cast all your anxiety on Him, because He cares for you. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion, looking for someone to devour. Resist him, standing firm in the faith, because you know that the family of believers throughout the world is undergoing the same kind of sufferings. And the God of all grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. To Him be the power forever and ever. Amen." You see, the power belongs to Him, not to us. Always has. It always will. And so we approach this all-powerful God poor in spirit, recognizing that without Him we're nothing, that He is our only help and He is our only hope, but He is the best help and He gives us the greatest hope. Let me encourage you. To inherit the kingdom of God, You must be poor in spirit. I like the story that's told about the mountain climber. I'm going to close with the story. You've probably heard it before. There was a man who wanted to climb all the high peaks that the earth had to offer. And so he went to Asia and he hired an expert mountain climbing guide to take him to the top of this very high peak. And it took many days to travel from the base to the top of the mountain. But when they finally approached the mountain, way high up where oxygen was hard to find and where the winds blew constantly and it was unsafe and the weather could change on a dime, and they finally got to this dangerous place, to the place of the summit of this mountain. And his guide pauses for a moment and he says, okay, we're about to make the summit. So your next step, the next step up you will take, you will be on the summit of the mountain. You go ahead and go. And so this man was so filled with adrenaline because he was finally going to accomplish the thing he had dreamed of accomplishing his whole life. He was going to summit this grand peak. And when he steps up and makes the step to the summit, he immediately begins to raise up and hold his arms above his head in triumph. And that's when his guide grabs him by the back and pulls him back down. And this man was so angry that his guide had the audacity to interrupt his moment of triumph. And that's when the guide says to the mountain climber, he says, listen, you cannot stand up on the summit of this mountain. The only way that you can make it to the top of this mountain is on your knees. And the truth is, in 2017, we need to spend a whole lot more time on our knees, don't we? Because his word tells us, blessed is the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. Now I'm going to ask you to rise with me, and we're going to close our time together in song today. But I want to encourage you, there is no greater day than New Year's Day of 2017 to get things right with God. Today is the day of salvation, and some of you here, maybe you've been putting off making a decision for Jesus. And I want to encourage you to make that decision. For some, it'll be a decision to accept him as your Savior, repenting of your sins, and to be baptized into Christ. For others, it may be a decision to lay something down that you've been carrying. Maybe it's a haughty, prideful spirit that has led you into frustration and unsatisfied living over and over again. That prideful spirit has destroyed your relationships, and it's left you in the pit, in the dumps. But blessed are the poor in spirit. Today, will you surrender whatever it is to Jesus that must be surrendered? I'll be standing right here. We will meet you here in the front. Come as we sing.